Welcome to the Real Comic Heroes Podcast. Your adventure into the world of comic book movies starts here.
Greetings, citizens, and welcome to another adventure of the Real Comic Heroes Podcast. My name is Travis Bowe from Watchmen Minute.
And I'm Patrick, here for another of our favorite in a franchise that has lasted throughout the ages.
I like that. That's a good way to...
I just made that up.
You got a career as a pitch man coming your way.
Hey, it has. At least this movie felt like ages.
That's true.
Yeah, we're going to be on Timothy Dalton Part 2.
Mm-hmm.
1989.
Of a long career of Bond movies with Timothy Dalton.
Yeah. 1989's License to Kill. Now, don't get it confused with License to Drive with the Coreys.
Oh, shit. I watched the wrong movie.
Just a friendly tip there.
Yeah.
Because that's the first one that popped up when I typed in license for some reason.
Yeah.
And I assume that is because of my wife, because she likes the Corey movie.
It's a good title for a Bond movie.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of surprising it hadn't been used before now.
Yeah. I'm guessing it's a title of an Ian Fleming like short story, maybe. Or I'm sure that if that's the case, I'm sure the story has nothing to do with what, you know, the story of the movie is. They often would just take the title and maybe one other small, you know, plot detail or element, but
yeah, because that's one of the phrases that I think is most like synonymous with Bond.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's what the 00 status is. It gives him a license to kill.
Yeah, so it's just kind of surprising it took until 89 to get that as the title. Yeah. All right,
got any taglines for us?
Boy, howdy. All right, let's see. I have not even read these. This will be the first reading.
Going in cold.
So strap it on. All right. Here we go. How many times can one man leave you breathless? If you get on his bad side, your number is up. That's a clunky tagline.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very generic.
Yep. Okay. Out for revenge. Glimpse behind the cool facade of 007 and see how sweet revenge can really be.
Okay, noticing
the
theme
here. Timothy Dalton is back as Bond with a vengeance. His bad side is a dangerous place to be. James Bond is out on his own and out for revenge.
That's the one I read.
Okay. Oh, that's weird, because the second one's the U.S. poster, it says.
Hmm.
A glimpse behind the cool facade.
Yeah, that one's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Very revenge heavy.
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, even my notes had that in there.
Oh, sure.
I think I wrote it in all caps with a bunch of exclamation points. Vengeance. All right.
You want to jump into this, I guess, the pre-title sequence cold open, which isn't
Actually, I was kind of curious what your experience was with this one.
I think I had watched this probably one time before with I probably mentioned it several times, the podcast James Bonding.
Oh,
They went through the entire franchise, and now they've done it a few different times in a few different ways. But I definitely watched it once. In preparation for that, and then I think that must have been it, because there were several sequences in here that I did not remember.
Yeah, I can see that being an easy thing to forget, because this movie feels like at least three movies, all wrapped into one.
Yeah.
So,
what about you? Any prior experience?
Not one single bit.
Okay.
I was excited to see the sharks, but I was disappointed there was no laser beams on their head.
Yeah, naturally.
Because I kind of hope that's what Bond movies do, is make animals that much more dangerous.
Sure.
But no, alas, I had to go and watch Austin Powers for that.
Yeah.
But I've never really had a Timothy Dalton experience with Bond, so.
Yeah.
Not, I mean, whatchamacallit, Pierce Brosnan's My Bond.
Right.
That's the first ones I could remember really watching. Plus he had a video game. GoldenEye. And then, yeah, so, I mean, it's the typical Bond feel, so it's like I've already watched it. But, yeah, it's definitely keeping in tone with the last movie with the angrier Bond.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So, and that may have just been the 80s action era kicking in.
Yeah, yeah. I do think at times that it can feel like a generic 80s action movie.
No, yeah, definitely. But, I mean, yeah. I just based on the themes, I was thinking Scarface.
Okay.
Like style, just because of the drugs and the Cuba thing.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking more like a Commando.
Okay, yeah.
Schwarzenegger, I think. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, let's talk about this before we get into like the act breaks. I just want to mention the opening title, or you know, like I said, the pre-title sequence, cold open, and it's an odd one because it is directly tied into the rest of the movie. You know, so many of them before are an unrelated scene. You know, it might lead into the main plot of the movie, but you know, a lot of times it's just Bond skiing away from bad guys and you know, foiling some attempt on his life, that kind of thing. But here it's just like he's just there in the back of a limo at right before Felix's wedding, you know?
Yeah.
So kind of weird. And then the Coast Guard / DEA show up and take Felix away, and Bond just rides along, and he's not a part of this, you know. It's irrelevant that Bond's even there at first, and he's told to just stay out of the way, you know.
He's an observer.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm.
It's like Felix doesn't even know him.
Yeah.
Sure, he's just gonna sit back and relax. Yeah, it was weird. Like it got, I mean, things escalated quickly. Like,
sure, there's a like weird, weird sequence. Stunts.
Like,
what's that?
A lot. There was an insane stunt work going on.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And, like, I was convinced that I missed the opening credits.
It feels that way. Yeah. There's even that weird scene where you meet Franz Sanchez, you know, who's our villain for the whole movie, and he, you know, busts in on Lupe and her, I don't know, lover, boyfriend, husband, I don't know, and they take him away, and he just starts like whipping her, I guess, in the back, and that's really weird.
It was like her lower back.
Yeah,
because you get to see it later.
Yeah.
Maybe to hide it from view of a dress or something.
Right.
I don't know. It's weird.
But yeah, like the stunts we get here are really good. A lot of the action, I think, in this movie is handled really well. Especially that helicopter.
Yeah, the helicopter versus plane thing.
Yeah, versus the plane. Yeah. I noticed that they really sell the like aerial stunts. You know, it looks like it's Bond, or it looks like it's Timothy Dalton for the most part. I'm sure he's not really doing any of the bit of being dangling from the helicopter, but you know, obviously someone is doing all that stuff for real. So I was really impressed with that type of stunt work that, you know, for the most part, it's all legit. I mean, I think they even use a real helicopter and plane sequence for the actual stunt of, you know, lifting a, or I guess dragging a plane. So
yeah, that was pretty cool.
Yeah. And I feel like this is a sort of inspiration for what Christopher Nolan did with Dark Knight Rises. Plane sequence at the start of that movie with Bane. So
yeah, I didn't even think about that. Yeah.
Pretty cool, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I was impressed. I was like, okay, let's do this. And then the wedding happens.
Then we skydive into a wedding. So,
Man, is it just me or is Felix like really old? It looks like he's dyed his hair to make him not look as old, but I felt like he was at least in his like late 60s. Like,
And that's the problem with Felix. We've seen a few Felixes over the years, and I think the first one, the Jack Lord, you know, mm-hmm. he looked like the CIA's version of James Bond.
Yeah.
And then like that quickly went away, and Felix started to become more of a maybe a few years younger version of like M, you know, usually not someone who's as good looking or as fit as Bond. So it's just kind of a, you know, more of a, an everyman sort of thing.
Yeah. I don't know. He looked frail.
Yeah. Yeah.
And way too old for that lady.
Yeah. I guess that's, yeah, we get the opening title sequence, which is, you know, for the most part, it's fine. I really don't like the License to Kill song that is playing here. I think it's Gladys Knight.
Yeah, it is.
Okay. It feels like they couldn't get Tina Turner. And so they get Gladys Knight. And that's, no offense to Gladys Knight. I don't know any of her other work, but it just seems like that's the vibe they wanted to go for. And then, you know, oddly enough, the next movie, Goldeneye, they're going to get Tina Turner for that song. Yeah. So, so maybe that's why I just kind of took it that way, that they were going for that vibe. That will take us into Act One, which is really just a continuation of this scene, really maybe an hour or two later after the wedding. So yeah, Act One starts with Bond celebrating at Felix's wedding, and then we'll end with Bond going rogue to, I guess, get revenge.
Yeah, he tells them to kiss it and takes mm-hmm. off.
Yeah. Do you have anything on the wedding or any of that stuff?
It completely took me out. Like, it just got so slow that insane action sequence. And I was just like, I don't care about this wedding.
Yeah. And like, there are several moments where Bond is kissing the bride in an inappropriate scene way. And then they even make a comment about like, that guy shows up, Killifer, I think. He says, well, I gotta go kiss the bride, you know. So is that a thing?
It might have been a thing in the '80s. Maybe know. I was too young to know.
Seems really weird.
And especially like a mouth kiss, like I could see on the cheek or something. But
sure.
I was like, okay, is this like a swinging lifestyle we got going on?
It kind of feels that way. It almost seems like, well,
it's Florida, so maybe.
Yeah. I almost thought like, well, we need to have Bond care that this woman is about to die. And so they'll have to be, you know, somewhat close, bordering on inappropriate, you know.
I don't know. But then when she is dead, it's like, eh.
It's like they almost want him to be the one who lost a bride, but they can't really do that again. Yeah. So they make it Felix's new bride, and yet Bond is just as close, you know. So kind of strange.
I could have done without that whole sequence, really.
Yeah.
The only thing it really gives you is that he hides something in that picture frame.
Well, yeah, that totally works.
That makes sense. But that's the only reason for this scene, really, is to show that. Yeah. But who gives a crap?
And a setup. It seems weird because it's like, I guess all of this stuff is happening in such a close proximity. You know, the wedding takes place, they bust Sanchez in the Florida Keys. So they're between Florida and Cuba, mm-hmm. if I'm not mistaken. So it's all about like keeping Sanchez, like apprehending him before he reaches Cuba, and then getting him to Quantico, the like military base.
Yeah,
which goes awry, obviously, because Sanchez has this, I guess, well-known, you know, $2 million to anyone who gets me out of, custody sort of thing. So, which is a really good escape scene, I think, that the underwater stuff. Yeah. It initially it reminded me of stuff like that we would get in Thunderball. Just those underwater scenes that went on forever and were super slow. But these, you know, they've managed to keep the action going, despite being underwater and everything. So I really dig the underwater escape scene where the van goes over the bridge, and then they've got a team of scuba guys with a little, I don't know what you call it, like a little, not a submarine, but just underwater craft,
kind of thing, yeah.
So yeah, I really dig that.
Yeah, they get a lot of use out of that thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you know that Della, Felix's wife, is played by Priscilla Barnes, who is the three-nippled fortune teller from Mallrats?
I did not know that. That's awesome. that's hilarious.
Yeah.
I had no idea. I mean, she kind of looked familiar, but I would have never in a million years have thought that was the fortune teller in Mallrats.
Yeah.
I just figured she was like in a bunch of action movies or something in the 80s.
I feel like she probably had a big career in the 70s and early 80s, probably. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Better role, you would say. More memorable.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that was a fun fact.
Yeah.
I'll have to go rewatch that now. Strictly for academic purposes.
Obviously.
Yes. Indeed.
Mm-hmm. Good show, old sport.
So that is a really funny scene, though. Like, where she takes it off and she eats it.
Works every time.
Yeah. It's great. Okay. So, things start picking up at this point.
Yeah.
So the wedding's over. I'm not falling asleep. And things start getting serious real quick.
Oh, yeah. I like that this one has the balls to throw Felix to the sharks after, you know, seemingly killing his new bride. Like, it's, you know, as far as stakes go, I can't think of a more severe, a more like savage event happening in a Bond movie. You know, I mean, they've definitely killed plenty. Well, I guess maybe like the dogs being set loose on, I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Hugo Drax's assistant, maybe, I think, in Moonraker. Like, that was pretty intense. And this, we don't even, I guess they just shoot Della, because I think when we see her, I think maybe she has a bullet wound. So we never even see that, but just the idea that, I guess maybe in the reaction that Felix has when they hint that they've already taken her out, or...
Yeah.
And of course,
that
just
was so brutal.
Like, yeah.
It's just like, they're not. And it, what I like, the way they do it with like the meat on one end.
Mm-hmm.
And then.
Yeah. Just an added level of just toying with him.
Which I assume was done so that the shark only eats his legs off, because I was shocked to see him later. I thought he was just going to be, you know, gone.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I didn't expect it to just be taking somebody's legs off, like they mentioned with the chainsaw. And
yeah, they say that he lost his left leg below the knee, mm-hmm. I think, and then they might be able to save his right leg. And something happened with his arm. I can't remember if they said he lost the arm or it's badly damaged. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, just the fact that they returned Felix back to his, I guess, his house or wherever they were staying, just with a note, you know, just the idea that they don't even just kill him. It's they're toying with him. They're like, you know, leaving him for dead in his own place after they've, you know, like I said, half fed him to the shark.
Yeah. What the notes say, it was like he didn't agree with something that ate him.
Yeah.
Or something. Yeah. Like, what the fuck? Like,
and we also get Benicio del Toro in this movie. It might be his first movie, but I love that line. You know, don't worry, we gave her a nice honeymoon.
Yeah, he I didn't recognize him at first. I saw his name in the titles.
Yeah.
Like the credits in the beginning. And I was like keeping an eye out for him, and I just did not realize how young he was.
I know.
I was like, oh, and he's still super creepy.
Oh yeah.
That face.
He's a great henchman.
Oh yeah. That was
And he did kind of disappears for a good portion of the he shows up in the bar fight when we meet Pam, and then I think he disappears until
In the
Act
plant.
Three.
Yeah.
But we get a new, or I guess we already kind of were introduced to another Bond ally, Sharky.
Yeah.
And I don't know if, because they're kind of working in this near Cuba area. Or no, I guess I'm thinking back to Dr. No, where he teamed up with Quarrel. And he was kind of, and then I know later on, maybe Live and Let Die, he teams up with Quarrel's son, I think, who's like just basically a taxi service kind of. He has a boat and he's getting him from point A to point B, and that's kind of what Sharky does here. He takes him out on his boat, so it's like I don't know if he's meant to be a Quarrel, but kind of fulfilling that similar role, I suppose.
It's a weird role to fill.
Yeah.
So yeah, Bond's full of rage and revenge as the lady that he mouth kissed after her wedding, and his best friend that's not in his 70s
Right.
somehow survives and
Yeah.
is in the hospital, so he's looking for blood.
Yeah, they want to go shark hunting. It's kind of weird to say with the guy's name is Sharky.
Sharky, yeah. But I thought there was a missed opportunity for a really good like one-liner
Oh.
when he's over there at the they sneak into the warehouse or wharf or whatever that thing
Yeah.
is, and they confront the guy that got the money
Yeah.
that was in the armored car, and
Oh, yeah, Killifer.
and then he sort of shoots shunts the guy into the water with the money, and then the shark does its thing, and the money's all covered in blood, and I swear to
Yeah.
God, I thought there was gonna be something about blood money or something,
Oh, okay.
but I was disappointed.
Yeah.
I was so looking forward to that because Bond is really good with those cheesy one-liners, and
Sure.
I was just I was expecting it.
Well, I think they also miss a chance earlier with when he dispatches the guy in the electric eel tank. If it was Roger Moore or
I
maybe
think that's
even
what it is.
Connery, it would be like, oh, positively shocking, something like that.
This Bond's not as quippy and
Yeah.
lighthearted.
There's one. He does get one in
He
later in the
does,
movie. I forget what it is now, but it might be after they bust out of the bar fight, maybe, and they get onto the boat. I don't remember, but
Yeah, I can't remember because after that she gets shot and he's worried, so
yeah.
I don't know. But yeah, I remember there was at least one in here
Yeah.
that didn't disappoint.
I really do love the throwing the big the they've already established that the suitcase full of money is really heavy
Oh,
when
yeah.
Sanchez gives it to Killifer, so we know that it's supposed to be pretty heavy, and I really do like the that moment of Bond throwing it at the dude just square in the chest so that he loses his grip on the chain that he's holding onto or whatever. So really like that bit of revenge.
Yeah, it
And
was
then
pretty
yeah, that's
brutal too.
yeah, oh
Like,
yeah. Very brutal.
Bond's not messing around.
No, and that kind of is what takes us to he has another run-in with I he's the DEA agent that we see at the beginning, but to me he's just Agent Johnson from Die Hard. He's like one of the Johnsons.
Yeah, the other Johnson's the bad guy.
Is it San? Okay, I thought
Sanchez.
so. Robert Davi. Okay.
Yeah, that's what was messing me up this whole movie is like I know
Yeah.
him from other stuff.
Yeah,
So
yeah.
I'm like, he's not Cuban.
Right.
He's Italian in Goonies. What the heck is he?
He's in that weird, I don't know, no man's land of ethnicity where he can be whatever they want him to be. I looked up, the woman that plays Lupe, Talisa Soto. Like I looked through her credits and just what else she was in, and it ranges from stuff like this where she's playing Latin, and then at one point she plays Native American. So it's just kind of like, well, you have non-white skin, so you're just going to work for any type of ethnicity we need you to be. So there's a lot of that in, you know, movies.
Yeah, it's just weird. He's just like a guy from Queens. So, I don't know. I mean, he does a good job.
I think he plays a good bad guy here, so.
But his accent thing, like, whatever he's doing, I don't know if I totally buy it, really.
Sure.
Like, to me, it kind of sounds like somebody trying to do a Cuban accent.
Mm.
But to be fair, I don't know that many people from Cuba. So.
Right.
But it just seemed a little too on the nose, maybe, like stereotypical.
Oh, okay.
Like,
yeah, it's a little Scarface.
Yeah, a little bit, but
yeah,
just a little bit, but I don't know. There was something off about it, and it could be that I know him from Goonies more.
Yeah,
and I'm just used to him from that. So, I don't know.
Let's see. Anything else before Bond goes rogue and takes us into Act Two?
Yeah, I mean, I just like M's like attitude with Bond.
Yeah.
Or he's like, your license to kill has been revoked. And then Bond's like, why I oughta. And then he like stops the other guy from shooting him as he's running away.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's not too serious about, you know.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Getting back at Bond for, you know, taking out his guys.
Sure.
Because, I mean, essentially he should have let him shoot him. Because he's a rogue agent at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
At the very least, not shoot to kill, but shoot to, you know.
Maim.
Maim or hurt or stop, yeah. You know.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a valuable asset to the English, like, intelligence agency. So
yeah.
You don't know what he's going to do or if he's going to compromise anything. Like, sure. It turns out he's compromising another mission that's going on. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It was weird. But M's just too soft on him, I guess. But yeah, we're going to Act Two.
Cool.
Going to Cuba, baby.
Hell yeah. Although, I mean, most of this movie, until they get to the third act, it's like most of this movie just feels like generic Caribbean Bond movie, you know? Jamaica, Cuba,
I'm assuming
Miami.
It's still Key West.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
Especially that bar scene that still feels like Florida to me.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's true. We get I think we kind of start off underwater and Bond's in this manta ray a getup, and I really love that.
I do too, but that did not look like a manta ray.
I kind of think it did until you see that, like, his flippers, you know.
It's so long and, like, triangular looking. It's just so weird.
I mean, those manta rays are pretty big, and that's basically
the shape
that they...
just seemed weird to me. Yeah. Like, right off the front, like, it seemed like it was more of a triangle than anything. Yeah. I don't know. I was like, what the hell is that when I first saw it?
It's funny because I thought about the crocodile that we see him use in Octopussy, and then the duck hat that
that's what I went to. I'm like a long line and amphibious type of disguises.
Yep, I like it. Yeah.
Oh, I totally loved that whole thing, but I was just like, "What the hell is that?" when I first saw it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome.
There's, I kind of jumped to like. Think Sharky ends up dead.
Yeah, he's like brought in on a boat tied up, and like, his name is Sharky.
Mm-hmm.
That's like with a bunch of other dead sharks or something.
Yeah, and then like Bond infiltrates the, what are they on, like a yacht?
Yeah, it's that
evil
white guy's lot.
So they're on his boat. He meets Lupe. And then he ends up, he ends up back underwater.
Well, this is the big, they're doing a cash swap for drugs on the seaplane.
Yeah.
And Bond, you know, harpoons a dude straight in the chest, dives into the water, steals the guy's oxygen.
Oh,
double whammy.
I like that.
And then they go after him, and that's when all this underwater fight, cut the hose, and then he shoots to the airplane, and that was pretty awesome.
Yeah, I like before that when he hitches a ride back on that like underwater drone thing that's transporting the drone. Takes the money to the plane. They swap the plane the money for drugs, and then they send the drone back. And I like Bond, you know, just knifing all the drug packages, just destroying their drug supply. And then that's when they kind of go after him again. Gets in the underwater fight, shoots the plane with the harpoon, and then we get like a water ski sequence, and then he catches back up to the plane.
Yeah, that part was weird.
Oh yeah,
like he got up to speed with the plane and jumped onto it. Like I was like, how in the hell did that work?
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing though. It does work because it's not like they're using miniatures or anything. Like that's a real person
I mean, I felt like there was a cut there where it brought him in. Like physically, I don't see how that's possible.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unless they took like a wicked turn or something.
That could be, or the plane. Yeah. Or the plane suddenly slowed down enough to get him up there. But
as they often do before takeoff, you just randomly throw the brakes on.
Yeah. It's another fantastic scene where Bond climbs into the plane like as it's flying off and chucks the two guys out of the plane and then
we're approaching Rambo level body count in this movie. Like it is insane.
Yeah,
but yeah, I love those scenes. Like they just show like the mannequin falling from the plane.
I like too when he sneaks onto the plane through like a little the cargo
door,
a little cargo hatch, and then the guy has the door open, so Bond just takes the hinge out of the door and shoves the guy out of the plane, and he's holding the door all the way
to that door. Yeah. It's like please be a parachute.
Yeah. So just another really well done sequence of action stunts and stuff. So yeah, the movie's really got that going for it. So
and more wasted money just chucked out the window, basically.
Yeah,
it's like Bond. I know it's not your queen's money, but come on.
The government might want that back.
Yeah. He's just willy nilly, just dumping it with sharks. Mm-hmm. Throwing it out windows of airplanes.
Sure.
And then he has like a couple bundles that he's going to use for, later expenses.
Yeah. And at some point throws a bunch inside like a pressure tank that.
Yep.
Yeah. The next thing is like Bond shows back up to Felix's because he knows that disc is there. So he does the sneak in. Put the disc in the computer, find out what Felix was going to do, which was to meet this Pam Bouvier at this particular bar.
I was shocked by the size of that disc drive.
Yeah.
It was like the whole front of the computer.
Right.
And then I was extra shocked that a disc also led to a DOS program.
Mm.
Like I've never seen that before.
That's a good point, yeah.
I mean,
this is 1980,
89, 88, 89.
Yeah. I always forget that CDs go back that far.
Yeah, and maybe that's how it was. I just never have experienced a CD-ROM and then a DOS system.
Well, they're probably, it's more the idea like, all this information is on the CD that we'll put in the computer. Yeah. But the filmmakers are probably more like, well, we just want to have the flashy new technology, even if it's not what would really be used for this.
And I mean, it could be used like that. I mean, it's just a data storage device. So
yeah,
it just took me out for a second. I was like, wait, what?
It is surprising to see the CD be used, but.
And the tray is just gigantic.
Oh, yeah. It looked like it should be one of those 5-disc changers.
Yeah, at first I thought it was a laser disc drive, like those record size ones.
Yeah,
and then it's size CD. Okay, I just wrote that down. Like, what the hell?
Yeah, yeah. it's funny just thinking of this technology that it seems too advanced for this 1989 movie and is now something that most computers don't even have CD drives anymore.
All right. So yeah, we get the Pam Bouvier, and then we go honky tonking.
Oh yeah,
the swamp bar.
Yeah, I like it. She's kind of she's an interesting character because right off the bat you can tell that she can take care of herself. You know, she's not going to be I even wrote down I wonder if she'll be, you know, a captive, like someone that that he'll have to save by the end of the movie. And then like kind of updated my notes once we finished the movie, and it was like she never really does become a captive that he has to save.
She's a good equivalent, like more than Felix even.
Yeah.
She's got her own thing going on, and Bond just gets involved with her mission kind of. I don't know if you've ever seen Police Academy.
Some of them. Okay. Oh, wait.
You know, with Steve Guttenberg and all
that. Okay, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I've probably seen most of the first one, but I don't know.
She reminds me of either A, Callahan, or B, the officer that trains Tackleberry, who's the guy that's really into guns.
Okay.
Like, super, like, can take care of herself and has, like, a sort of a strong demeanor to her.
Okay.
So it just made me think of those two characters because they're both like, or both of those characters in Police Academy are, you know, self-sufficient and
sure
are just as capable as anyone else in the movie, if not more so sometimes. So it just, there must've been a theme going on in the 80s at that time that, you know, maybe they were moving towards a character for women that wasn't as damsel-y. Yeah.
We just talked about RoboCop.
Murphy.
Who's the partner?
Or not Murphy. Murphy's the RoboCop.
Yeah.
What's her name? Crap. Lois.
Lois. Yeah. Kind of like that a little bit. Like.
Yeah.
I mean, she's also still a love interest here, but just.
Yeah, that's the only. It's kind of weird. Like, she's kind of into him, and then she gets miffed about Lupe, and but they're never, until the very end, they're never really that tight together. They're more like sort of cat and mouse a little.
Sure.
Like, give and take here and there, and they're not totally committed to it until the very end.
Well, and it's weird how often there's so many scene changes in this movie, and Bond will like jump from being in a scene with Lupe and being in a scene with Sanchez and back to him and Pam. And then back to there's so many interactions that Bond has in this movie, especially in this second act. At this point, we're kind of getting into an area where it's like, it's really starting to drag. We first get a scene with Wayne Newton and it's like, they're setting up this, I guess it's like a secret auction.
Yeah, it's like a televangelist style fundraiser that's disguising a drug auction.
And he's using it when he says, you know, whatever the auction is or whatever the telethon number goal, like that's the secret code, I guess, for how much it's going to cost for anyone to get in on this, bidding on these drugs or something like that. Yeah. I kind of like the idea, but
it's weird because it's being filmed in Cuba. Would anyone in the U.S. have access to this show?
Oh yeah.
That's what threw me off. I'm like, wait, how are people in Chicago watching this? Cause they mentioned the Chicago chapter.
Yeah. All drug lords have a private satellite channel.
Yeah. That's the only thing I could think of is it's some secret underground satellite feed or something.
And it's
cables around, so there's a secret cable channel.
Yeah. We're in a weird part in the second act here where there's no real hint towards a villainous plot. You know, we know about drugs. I mean, that's the the whole thing. And then we're starting to get hints about Asian drug cartel that's now in the mix. You've got this thing going on with Wayne Newton, you know, doing this secret bid thing,
evangelical fundraising thing.
Yeah. Soon we're gonna find out about some Stinger missiles that are gonna be in play. That was weird. And then you find out that. I'm kind of jumping ahead a little bit. Like, you find out, like, surprise, Quang, who is one of the supposed Asian drug lords, is really with Hong Kong Narcotics.
Yeah.
And he's played by a very familiar actor. Like,
Shang Tsung.
Yeah.
Mortal Kombat, like, man.
Huh?
Mortal Kombat, Shang Tsung. Yeah.
He's been in so many movies.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what I immediately saw. I was like, whoa, Shang Tsung's in this? Awesome. Yeah.
He turns out to be a good guy. You know, you think he's going to be like one of the bad guys, but.
Well, historically.
Yeah. But then he's like taken out of the movie real quick because Bond, Bond follows him? I forget how he. Well, oh, yeah.
No,
he gets attacked by the ninjas.
Yeah. It's like, how did they find him?
Yeah. So then you got Quang revealing himself to be a narcotics agent, and then a British agent appears out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And then just as quickly, Sanchez and his like paramilitary force has a tank and they start firing on their building. And so everyone else is dead. And then Bond gets taken by Sanchez.
They think he was captured by the guys that were after him, so he thinks Bond's a good guy, or not a good guy, but can be trusted somewhat.
Yeah, possibly. And it's kind of a weird thing for a Bond movie, because we did have a scene earlier where Bond's in the casino, and they've got, you know, cameras on Bond, and they find out, like, who he is, and he's a high roller or something, and Sanchez is just like, oh, let him play, you know. And in any other movie, it would have been, oh, this is really James Bond. Let's let him do his thing for a while and see where it goes. And so you kind of, I guess I expect it to go that way here. And then it's well into, like, you know, this upcoming stuff where they take Bond with them after, you know, finding him in this, you know, building that they just blew to hell, like, and it slowly like dawned on me, like, oh, they're not just toying with Bond. He actually trusts Bond. He thinks he's on his side, or it's
he
just
could
this,
be on his side. Like, I don't know if he trusts him, but
I mean, I don't know.
He was tied up by the guys that
betrayed
him, so therefore, I guess
enemy of my enemy is my friend.
Yeah, kind of thing. And then he doesn't really trust him quite yet. I don't think that happens until a little bit later when he tips off on the Wave Crest guy or whatever.
Yeah.
But there's it's always been weird to me, like, that nobody knows who the hell this James Bond guy is.
I know.
Like, he doesn't hide his identity ever.
Right. So, although he does, I think in the first act, he does approach that. That warehouse place, and he does drop the thing that he's from Universal Exports, and he wants to talk about, you know, doing some business. So I do like that. I do appreciate that. But
nine times out of ten, he's like, hey, everybody, James Bond here. 007.
Mm-hmm. Even hints that he was like former British intelligence, and now he's like, left that or whatever, so
which is true in this case.
Sure.
I was just gonna say, I know there was a guy doing research on him, one of Sanchez's guys.
Yeah, he's very,
like, never believe what I found out. And, you know, he's like, oh, former British agent. And he's like, how'd you know? But could his research not show that he was friends with Felix Leiter? He was in his freaking wedding.
Well, and he was also like a part of the raid on Sanchez at the beginning of the movie. Yeah. So I kept thinking, like, somehow that was gonna,
he must have never seen Bond, because I think Bond, when he was, you know, going fishing, was on the top of the plane, so he couldn't really see him. So I don't think he ever really got a good look at Bond, maybe.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, they were so close in proximity that they almost... That was what I think I had a hard time getting my head around, is that, well, that whole opening sequence, like, they were, you know, right there together. But yeah, it's one of those things that they didn't stand face to face, and, you know, and Sanchez didn't know that this is the same man. So I kept expecting that to kind of come around and be revealed, that Sanchez knew the whole time, and it really never happens. It's like, at a certain point, if you look at this from Sanchez's perspective, he gets betrayed by Bond in the third act when he...
Yeah. You know, oh, yeah. He's like, what the hell?
Yeah. I think that's just what is so weird to me, how long the movie goes with Sanchez thinking that Bond is an ally.
Well, luckily, was it Dario never shows up?
Right.
Because they've already met at the bar and...
Okay, yeah.
Kind of narked on him and the PAM executive administrator or whatever. Because, I mean, that's the whole reason you don't see him until the plant, is because he's the one thing that could mess up that whole thing.
Right.
Which is kind of lazy, but... like, I would have liked it if he was at that estate that Bond was staying at.
Sure.
At Sanchez's property.
I'm trying to remember when Dario reappears in the third act. It's
on like a tour.
Yeah. But I feel like there was a reason that he was gone the whole time. Like, he was maybe getting the missiles.
Maybe. It wasn't clear to me.
I feel like, like when he shows up, I feel like it's like, oh, I'm back from doing this thing. Like, I feel like there was a reason that, but I can't remember now what it was. Obviously wasn't integral. It was just a reason to not have him around Bond, I suppose. So, let's see. I didn't take a ton of notes kind of in this last half of the second act, because it was just starting to drag on so much, it felt like, and so many scene changes. And at a certain point, Bond leaves Sanchez's, island estate or wherever they're at.
We forgot
Lupe. Lupe helps, like, what's that?
We forgot the most important part.
Oh?
There's a new field operative, Q.
Oh, shit, yes.
He even gets a disguise.
And that's kind of where I think what I was starting to get to, because it's like Lupe helps smuggle Bond out of this Sanchez's place.
Yeah.
And then...
Because Q's around before that.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, because he provides the plastic toothpaste explosives that he uses on the window. And then... it's captured by the ninjas.
Yeah. Okay. That's right. That's the problem. It's like, there's so many things going on with this movie. It's so hard to remember, like, the comings and goings, you know?
Because I think he already had his random guy sweeping up a street disguise.
Yeah.
At this point.
That's towards the end after Bond has been taken.
Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
I'm trying to think now, because I'm kind of getting confused as far as, like, what happens when. I remember that Lupe comes to Bond's hotel, or she interacts with Q and says, you know, oh, he's been taken, and Q is kind of like, well, we'll get him back, and that's when he puts on his street sweeper disguise. And so it's kind of Q and Pam are teaming up a little bit to get Bond back.
Yeah, because judging by my notes, it looks like that Q part is after the Wavecrest guy goes Kananga on us.
Oh, okay.
Which is weird, because that was another drug-related Bond movie. So
if
you're doing drugs, you're going to get pressurized.
Yeah, I really dig the Bond setting up Crest. Like, he drops a hint earlier as far as hinting to Sanchez that something about the money and who's coming later to get money.
The detail is there was going to be a payment with cash or something.
So he kind of drops a hint then, and then when he gets back onto Sanchez's boat, you know, he takes the money and makes it look like Crest has hidden the money so that when they come downstairs or whatever, that it looks like.
And that's a horrible hiding place.
Sure.
A window. Jesus.
Right.
Yeah. This whole thing, I think, is like a master move by Bond, because he's seeding like betrayal.
Yeah.
Because then he even mentioned something about after, you know, the balloon incident, which is awesome, by the way.
That sure, the pressure thing.
Oh,
yeah.
That was brutal.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, I just figured there'd be more than one. I mean, who would be crazy enough to take you on their own?
Right.
That line. I was like, oh, that's sweet.
Yeah.
It's just sowing those seeds of paranoia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that was my favorite. Sure. That was my favorite tactic of Bond's in this whole movie, was how he was playing them like a fiddle.
I don't think I have much else for Act Two. I mean,
yeah,
so much happens, but it's just too much happening to keep anything straight and make any.
Yeah, it all sort of coalesces into the like all this is going on, and then after he gains his trust by, you know, giving him that tip about the Crest stash,
yeah,
it sort of then just flows right into Q sweeping and then going to the plant.
Yeah.
So we move right. Q sweeps us into Act Three, pretty much.
Sure does. Yeah.
Good job there. And for the record, James Bonding has screwed me over on this, because now I can't stop looking at Q's hands. Especially when he's showing the gadgets.
I know.
Those are huge meat mittens he's got on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Holy crap.
He's got some big hands.
Yeah. So thanks a lot.
No. Yeah. So. Act Two ends with Bond being taken on a trip to the drug processing plant / meditation center.
Yeah.
And that is a sentence that I just said.
Yeah, it's Bond. Anything's possible.
Yeah. It's so bizarre. Like the televangelist character that Wayne Newton plays. It's like, it's like this religious cult thing that they have going on with their own almost like a wellness center, but it's really a cocaine refinery, I guess,
which is the least meditative drug you could take. Weed I could understand,
sure.
Coke not so much. All right, so yeah, Act Three.
Yeah,
very we got a
yeah, they take them on this tour of the plant, and you get this science lesson where they're mixing gasoline and cocaine and just filtering out the cocaine later.
Yeah.
So okay.
Sure, why not?
Yeah.
Luckily, everyone has to wear a mask in this plant, because you can get addicted instantly.
Sure.
But luckily, you know, that can possibly be absorbed by your eyes,
mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, weird.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's convenient for Bond for a little bit, at least.
Sure.
But Benicio's suspicious eyes are onto him.
Oh yeah. And like, as Bond is on this tour, Pam shows up, and she has she's got like a wad of cash in a bag, and so she gets taken to Wayne Newton, and I really dig that scene, because it seems like Wayne Newton playing Wayne Newton, where he's like, hello, my child, and, you know, takes her.
That's Professor Joe Butcher.
Yeah.
Where did that name come from?
I don't know. He takes her like to his bedroom so that they can meditate together,
mm-hmm.
you know, after she's given him the cash. And then, you know, of course she points the gun at him, and what he's like, bless you, child. Like, he's not even mad. I really dig that.
I like to think that after that scene was filmed, he's like, so when are we going to start the filming?
Yeah.
Like, he was just doing that as usual.
Yeah, you've given me my standard bag of cash.
There's a woman ready for the Newton.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like business as usual for me. She pulls a gun on me because I get too creepy or handsy.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, but I loved his character.
Yeah,
even like when she steals the money back.
That is the best. Just Bless you, child.
He's a weird dude, man.
Yeah.
I just assume he's got some mental disorder.
Mm.
Because it doesn't seem like anyone would have that reaction. Like,
Yeah.
after getting all that happen to you, like
Right.
stealing the money, and like,
Yeah.
that's just a
He's
weird
just so
response.
unfazed by,
It's like he's on a hallucinogenic or something. Like, I don't, it's a weird character.
Who knew that gas tainted cocaine would make
That's
you,
true.
you know,
Probably burn a hole right through your
make
nasal
you
passage.
very, yeah, make you very euphoric, I
I
guess.
guess. Oof.
Yeah, so that's when like shit kind of hits the fan. Bond throws a creates a fire in this
Yeah, he does.
lab tour that they're on, and you know that spreads quickly. Everyone basically is fleeing the facility. They keep making a point to show that Sanchez doesn't care about any of the money. He's really only concerned with the tankers filled with the gasoline cocaine mixture, at least up to a certain point. So it's like as they keep losing money, you know, Sanchez has this assistant,
Yeah.
and he keeps pointing out like, oh, that's such and such $1 million, and Sanchez will say, I don't care about that, just get this and this, get the missiles, I think he's concerned with, get the tankers out of here. And then, you know, the assistant again says like, well, we just made a deal with the Asians, and you know, that's their money or something. And Sanchez is again like, I don't care about that. I really actually like that assistant character. You know,
Yeah.
he's kind of been with Sanchez for most of the second act, and I really like his character.
Yeah,
He's not
he's
as weaselly as a lot of other little side characters would be in previous movies. So,
just a logical accountant.
yeah.
He's like, "Hey, we're losing a bunch of money here."
Yeah.
He's definitely focused on that. Like, he's not even, it's almost like he doesn't care about Sanchez, just more about the
Sure.
money and
Yeah.
I guess the status that he has within that group.
Yeah.
But yeah.
And there's like another wrinkle that they kind of weave in with I don't know if it's Sanchez's like military guy who is trying to get the missiles loaded into a helicopter, and he
Yeah.
gets caught because he's trying to, I guess, take the missiles for himself, maybe. So that, of
Yeah,
course,
that whole
ends.
missile thing, I'm just, what?
Yeah, see, and that's the thing, like in when they drop the hint about the missiles, that Pam is kind of here to because of the missiles. Initially, you know, she was trying to either stop or prevent him from getting these missiles. And I thought that that was leading to something where his ultimate goal or ultimate plan was going to be use these missiles to either hold something for ransom, almost in that world domination type thing. Like, I'm going to shoot down a, I think they even
Oh,
say like
yeah.
he could use them to shoot down a passenger plane or something to that effect. Like, it feels like the missiles are meant to be a real big,
Yeah, like a big chip in this whole scheme,
yeah.
but
And then they just end
nothing.
up being just used in a handheld rocket launcher,
Yeah.
and you know, he goes through like three of them. You know, he's got four of them, I think, and he ends
Yeah.
up using, I think, three of them. So it's like it's not even that they're that precious. You know, he just kind of uses them to try and kill Bond, and they're, you know.
I thought I heard that they were being used as a bargaining chip to offer a pardon for him.
Okay. See, it's
For some kind,
yeah,
like if
that's.
he gave him back, he got pardoned. So I thought they were like a get out of jail free kind of card.
Okay. Oh, that explains the sequence where Pam is in that dude's office next
Yeah.
door to Sanchez. Okay. So
Yeah.
he's gonna get the missiles to give back to the US so that he can get out of this situation. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I
So
mean,
that's the whole piece of that. It's not that very much integral to the plot or
yeah.
the plan he has, but it's more of like a get out of jail free card.
Okay. So just another thing to create some a wedge between Sanchez
Yeah.
and this guy. Okay.
Yeah, because Bond gets pissed because she was there, so he thought she was betraying him, but she was
Yeah.
really doing this other deal because she's got her own shit going on.
Yeah. Just kind of
So.
another like element that maybe wasn't necessary. Just more
like I said,
stuff.
It's like three movies all in one.
Yeah,
like, there's a lot going on.
Mm-hmm. But you know what else is going on? A big tanker truck chase that.
Well, we didn't even get to the Temple of Doom scene with Benicio getting ground up. Sausage.
Yeah.
That was like, I immediately went to that because there's a conveyor belt and then a grinder of some sort to.
Oh, man, yeah.
That was an awesome sequence.
It sure was.
Because Pam comes in and saves Bond's butt again.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was weird. I thought, because Bond was like hooked on the end by his restraints. And while he's getting, dragged out to the grinder, he's, talking to Sanchez.
Yeah.
And, mentioning who's got the money. And that's when I saw Sanchez, like, his face was like, geez, I can't trust anybody. And he just like that. I think that's the point where he finally just loses it. And
yeah,
but he does leave Bond to, assume he'll die.
Sure.
As a Bond villain should.
Of course.
And then Benicio has his fun. And I thought he was actually going to just like, I thought it would take him no time at all to cut through that, honestly.
Yeah.
It seemed to take a really long time. So at one point I thought he was trying to cut his hand off. So I was like, what the hell's taking so long?
I want to savor this.
Like 5 centimeters of it cut in like a half hour.
Yeah.
So that was weird, but I loved that she came in and shoots him and then he gets dragged down into that.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just intense.
It's like, brutal. Yeah.
He's holding on to Bond and just, you can hear him scream even after he shouldn't be able to scream anymore.
Sure. Yeah.
Like, I'm pretty sure he's all the way through and the grinder's done and I can still hear his scream echo. And then, then we get into this big tanker chase extravaganza / airplane.
Yeah. It's a legit, it's another great stunt spectacular, as James Bonding would call it. Like, it's this... the sequence that, there are 4 trucks, I think, and Bond and Pam, like, she gets him there, gets him onto the trucks, and then that just, it's like, he just proceeds to kind of pick him off one at a time.
I forgot, I wrote, I guess Bond's car in this movie is a golf cart.
Yeah. Yeah. I think he drives like a Ford Thunderbird, when he's leaving Felix's at the beginning, and then that's basically
because he's getting driven around the rest of the movie.
Yeah,
like, even the golf cart, I guess Pam's driving. So
yeah,
and she takes the money from Professor Newton.
He gets around a lot by boat and plane in this movie because he shows up to the honky tonk bar in a speedboat. Mm-hmm. Sharky drives him around in a boat at a certain point, and then 2 different like planes that he gets in. So
I forgot about the tanker truck driving on the one set of wheels.
Oh, how could you forget that?
Yeah. I was starting to think he didn't know how to drive, and that's why everyone else is driving.
Yeah,
because
I think that's just so that he can avoid missile fire.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure like that's a actual stunt that they did,
how, I don't know.
It's a really fun sequence. It goes on maybe a little bit too long.
Yeah. But I was going to say, it's hard to keep track of because it is a lot of tanker switching
I like that. It just ends with Sanchez and Bond are like on the back of a truck together kind of fighting. And then because there's no one driving, or maybe the driver jumps out.
Yeah.
The tanker just drives kind of off of not a cliff, but like a drives kind of into
hill.
Drives into a hill and just starts rolls over. And it's not something that Bond is either aware is about to happen. So he can't prepare to, tuck and roll at the last second. Like, he just goes off this hill with Sanchez, and they both, end up in the same condition. Ultimately Sanchez kind of gets the upper hand because he has a machete to Bond, but I like that it kind of is random as far as which one of them could have survived or gotten the upper hand. So it's a very like Mad Max kind of ending.
Yeah, that's a little bit.
Because
Sanchez cut the brake line, which I think is why the driver jumped out because he couldn't stop it.
Yeah. And then the whole thing has like been spewing gas the whole time because Bond opened up the end of it. So that's kind of why Sanchez maybe is I guess coated in, or soaked in gasoline.
Oh yeah. And they, when they roll, I'm sure it goes all over the place. Yeah. Cause I think the heat comes up towards the back of the truck where it's spewing out to Sanchez.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, there's going to be gas everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah.
With, all the rolling they did.
Yeah. So of course Bond sets him alight with his, wedding present that he got from Felix and Della.
I love the irony that it was Felix's lighter that killed him.
Nice.
I was like,
it's a genuine Felix lighter.
Yes. And I remember thinking, wow, that thing's like a flamethrower. And then,
yep.
Oh, well, I guess it was. Yep. And then they have a party.
Yeah. Yeah. And Felix is way too chipper on the phone when we, you know, you cut back to him. It's like, it should be like, well, thanks, Bond, for getting revenge, but now I guess I'll have to figure out how to live alone. For you know, it's instead it's like I forget what Felix says, but it's just it's the tone of like, well, thanks, Bond, I will see you soon. You know, just very it's like I said, just way too upbeat for someone that just lost his wife and was attacked by sharks.
Yeah, a shark. Figure out how to live life with my one remaining limb.
Right. Like, I guess I'll be in therapy, you know, for a long time, learning how to use this new prosthetic limb that they'll give me. And
I got to learn how to wipe my own ass.
Oh, man. Yeah.
I don't even have a wife to help me anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, he should be psychologically just destroyed.
Right.
He should just be in like a vegetative shock state.
Right.
At this point, like, not that much time has gone by.
No, I mean, maybe a week.
Yeah, maybe a few weeks.
That's yeah, what maybe, I was like.
Because Bond does get knocked out for a couple days here and there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, then we had our subsequent water makeout session at the end.
But it kind of a weird love triangle that, because typically, if Bond.
Lupe.
What's that?
I never understood the Lupe thing.
That was weird. It's weird because I think typically one of the women would have turned and either been working for the bad guy or revealed that they were working for the bad guy, you know? So usually if Bond hooks up with two women in a movie, it's one of them will usually be a villain, you know, or one of them will be good and get killed. So it's weird to come to the end of the movie and he's made time with both of these ladies and it's just kind of, well, I guess I'll go be with this one because
she's not an accessory to horrible crimes.
Yeah. It's real weird.
I don't know what Lupe has or has not done.
Sure. I think she's a victim. You know, she was the girlfriend that was kind of a prisoner, you know, I mean, pretty much a prisoner.
Yeah, but she seems to be able to boss everybody around. So.
Well, sure, because she was like,
she
was Sanchez's girlfriend. So
I'm just saying, she's probably done some shady stuff.
She probably knows some stuff, but doesn't
At the very least, she didn't do anything about it.
Yeah,
like she just let things happen around her.
Yeah,
but Pam is, you know, miffed as she sees Bond mouth kissing another lady. I assume it's her wedding. And then then they go off and have a winking fish statue.
Yeah.
While they make out in the water. It was a weird ending.
It was. And again, just pervy Q looking on and
Q.
Yeah. I really do like how much Q is in this movie and it's not just
a shocking amount. And did they ever use the camera? Like the laser one?
Not the laser. No.
Okay.
He does use that
sniper.
Yeah, turns that, I guess it's a camera, turns it into a sniper rifle. Yeah.
Because I remember the camera being a big part of the opening sequence.
Yeah. I think it has for the past several movies. They've featured like photography a lot as if it's like, they're not even spy cameras. They're just,
just
flat out film, you know,
giant nighttime
Pentax
camera.
Yeah. Cameras. Yeah.
Tourist camera.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's the end of the Dalton. Yeah.
Can't wait to see Dalton in his next Bond movie. I'm sure it'll come in like 2 years. So we'll be talking about that, you know, right around the corner.
Yeah.
Do you,
nice wrap up. Yeah.
Yeah. You want to jump into our most villainous and most heroic?
This planet, these people, they are nothing to me.
You were made to be ruled.
The universe is power. You unstoppable power.
Come to me, son of Jor-El. Kneel before Zod.
And I am that force. I am that power.
In the end, you will always kneel.
Kneel before your master.
Yeah, there's a lot to choose from here.
There is. For me, it's absolutely just Sanchez killing Della and feeding half of Felix to a shark.
Yeah, it's not even close. Like, that has to be the number one.
Yeah.
Like, that was just cold-blooded. Like, yeah, I can't even think of what would even come close to that.
I mean, we see Sanchez do some other, you know, more sadistic stuff, like with the putting that guy in the pressure chamber.
Yeah, that's the only
thing
I could think of, but that,
I mean,
was
that's
pretty quick. And
well, and he's killing a bad guy, so
yeah,
it's not, you know.
That, like, I guess another villainous moment would have been him whipping Lupe.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it was just so weird. And like,
killing
violent.
Killing, you know, Sharky being killed, but we don't see that happen.
Yeah, it was off screen and I wasn't sure if he was dead or unconscious.
Right, same here. Yeah.
Because
even the plot isn't like world domination. It's really just, it's just a story, you know, a movie about him trying to keep his drug cartel in business. I mean, it's
about a drug empire, at least, because that's why he's getting the Asians in to expand his empire from, what do you say, it was Alaska to the Caribbean.
Yeah, that's true. It's like
branch out to the east.
Yeah.
So it's world drug domination, I guess. But yeah, I mean, that is the only glaring obvious villainous moment to me. Like, that has to be the number one. And then most heroic.
I believe there's a hero in all of us.
I just finally know what I have to do.
That keeps us honest.
I'm here to fight for truth and justice in the American way.
Gives us strength.
You will give the people of Earth an ideal to strive towards.
Makes us noble.
And I know in my heart that it's right.
Honestly, I like the part where Pam saves Bond. Like, she comes in with the gun.
Okay.
And shoots at the plant and shoots Benicio / Dario. I thought that was a cool, like, hero moment. Like, she's like, I got this.
I kind of struggled with finding a hero moment, because it's like, you know, I think there were several heroic things, but I mean, most of the third act with the truck sequence is very heroic for Bond, you know, just she drops him off from the plane and he just proceeds to kind of take these trucks out one at a time. I guess it would be, I like what you said with her saving him. I was trying to think of like any other time that someone was saved like that, but that might be the only real one.
There's another cool hero moment at the very beginning where they parachute down after catching Sanchez for the first time. And sort of the look on his wife's face when he comes in. And like, that's a pretty heroic looking, like, if anyone entered a wedding like that.
Yeah.
Like, after snaring a plane that everyone saw with a helicopter.
Yeah. I like there's just, a little throwaway thing that happens there. Like as the opening titles are beginning, they two assistants, bridesmaids, someone like they grab their parachutes as if it's like the train of her dress, you know? Yeah. So they all walk into the church, you know, with their parachutes like trailing them. That's funny.
Yeah.
So. I don't really have a good standout heroic moment. Cause it's all like an overall revenge story.
Yeah.
For Bond, for, you know, Felix and Della. And he also manages to stop, you know, at least this arm of a drug empire. So,
yeah, I think the Asian side gets away.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I love that when everyone's like running from the plant. Mm-hmm. All the zealots and the plant workers, and it's just a mix.
Especially when she just gets in that last fuck you to yeah. Wayne Newton by grabbing that bag of money. I love that.
Yeah.
So what are your what are your overall thoughts and rating for License to Kill?
Yeah, I mean overall, it's a long movie.
Yeah.
And it, like I said, it's almost like three different movies in one, and it could have been done a lot quicker and cleaner.
Mm-hmm.
It felt like it kept dragging on. Just when you thought it was going to be over, it just kept going. But it had an insane amount of great action sequences.
Yeah.
So it's entertaining from like a look at what we can do standpoint. But as far as the story, I really didn't care. I'm just like, okay, he's dealing drugs, bad guy. He fed his friend to a shark, but he's also mouth-kissing that dude's wife. are they really great friends? Plus, the dude was already like 80, so he was going to be dead probably in a week anyway. so maybe it was a favor to put him out earlier before, you know, things got worse. Yeah, I'd probably put it just at like a 2.5.
Okay.
Like, it's fun to watch. I'll never watch it again. Never. It's too long.
Just too long.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was, if I watch it, it's going to be YouTube style with clips.
Oh, okay.
Like, just to see the cool action sequences.
Mm.
I didn't care about the girls in this, like, one bit.
Sure.
I felt like Pam was in and out of it, like in weird sections. Overall, I liked her, but it just seemed disconnected.
I think that's how everything felt. Everything just felt in and out. Like one minute, you know, Bond's here with Pam, then he's with Sanchez, then he's back to her, and then Q shows up, and then we go. It jumps around so much that's the second act for me was a nightmare of trying to keep things straight and just kind of feeling like you're okay. Well, we must be halfway through the movie. And it's like, I checked the time and I still had an hour left and I felt like, holy shit. Like so much has already happened that apparently is inconsequential, you know?
Cause normally we're out to stop something, but here we're just out to kill him for revenge. So it's weird. He just happens to foil a plan in the process. Mm-hmm.
That's kind of like you said about just not caring about the story, and I kind of felt the same way. It's because, there is no overarching plot here. It's just drugs, which makes this whole movie, I think, feel like a generic 80s action movie. I think you could take the Bond elements out of it, the Q, the brief scene with M, and swap out Bond for, like we said at the beginning, like a Scarface maybe, or like I mentioned Commando, or I'm thinking like Stallone's Cobra maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Just any kind of generic 80s action hero, I think you could put in this role and it becomes just another action movie. There's really nothing that felt James Bond to me.
Yeah.
You know, except from the obvious like Bond gadget, Bond, you know, side characters that they incorporate in. But on the other hand, like I'm not sure why the Dalton era of these two movies. You know, I'm not sure why it's talked about as if it's a blemish on the franchise, because I think he's good.
Yeah.
The movies are enjoyable. I think this one is just far too long, but you know, I don't know. Tonally, they're different from like the Moore era that we just left. But I do think he has a lot of Sean Connery in his Bond that I really enjoy. Sure. But I think I'm at like a 3. You know, it's very middle of the road. I enjoyed it a lot more than I thought I would, because I thought this one was considered like one of the worst ones. But after watching it, it's kind of like, I don't know why it would be considered.
I mean, it was one of the, decent
it
to
was
watch.
Totally fine. It was
really long and clunky.
yeah. I'm there with you as far as it was just way too long. But I did enjoy the stuff that works, really works. The action is super solid.
Yeah.
They made me care about like underwater action scenes again, you know, like stuff like that, like really, really works. So what the stuff I liked, I really liked, but it was just too long. So, like I said, I'm at a 3.
Okay. Yeah. I was debating a 3, but it was a little less than okay. Just because of the clunky nature of it.
Yeah. So a 2.75, I think, is fitting for a License to Kill.
Yeah, I think I was on M's side. Let the Americans handle it, Bond. This isn't your kind of thing.
So yeah. So what other crisis was happening that didn't get resolved because he didn't report for duty?
Just a pandemic virus that got let loose. No big deal.
That makes
millions
sense,
of people died.
So that's it was cool. Just like a apocalypse style world between here and GoldenEye.
I assume millions of people died because Bond was busy getting revenge.
Probably. And deciding which of the two ladies he was going to end up with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Bond.
Timothy.
Am I going to do it for License to Kill, I think? I
think so. We're done there.
Yeah. Done with Bond for a little while then. Yeah. Till GoldenEye. But we are not done.
Dun, dun, dun.
What do we got next?
Or dipping into another franchise.
Yeah.
It's a spooky franchise.
Slowly growing franchise. Yeah.
Yeah. True. Yeah. The one that's revitalized yet again.
Yeah.
I guess.
In so many years.
Ghostbusters 2, Electric Boogaloo. I mean, Return of the Ooze. Wait. But this is just Ghostbusters 2.
Ghost Strike Back.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
What was like with this era? Because we also had not too many years after Return of the Ooze with the Ninja Turtles. Secret of the Ooze? Yeah. I can't remember. A lot of ooze. Because in this one, we got plasmic ghost ooze that makes toasters dance, I think.
Should be interesting.
What could go wrong?
Yeah.
I'm interested to revisit it because I historically have looked down on this movie.
Okay.
So I'm interested to see if it looks any better for having given myself a break from it for so long.
Sure.
And with the last one coming out, with the McCarthy and Wig one.
Oh, sure.
So I know we have yet another one coming, so we'll see.
Stranger Things, the Ghostbusters movie.
Yep. So yeah, Ghostbusters 2, can't wait.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be interesting. It's not one I have a ton of experience with, so.
Yeah, I think I've shunned it, and I don't know if it's a fair shunning. So yeah. We'll see.
We'll find out.
But yeah, until next time.
Stay drug-free, kids.
Just say no. Reagan.
That's right. The real hero of this movie.
Yes. If you do drugs, kids, you'll be pressurized and explode. The more you know.
That's right.
At the stroke of midnight, on New Year's Eve of the last decade of the 20th century, America's largest city is about to pay for the nastiness of its inhabitants. when that day comes. When the slime starts to rise.
The Titanic just arrived.
When ghosts start arriving by the boatload.
We gotta find the guys.
There's only one thing to do.
Let me out! Let me out!
Sometimes weird things happen. Someone has to deal with it. And who are you gonna call?
All right, suck in the guts, guys. We're the Ghostbusters.
The superstars of the supernatural are back to nuke the spooks.
Two in the box.
Ready to go.
We be fast and
they be slow.
Make some time.
Don't put any of those old cheap moves on me.
No.
It's different.
I have all new cheap moves.
Raise your spirits.
If we don't do something by midnight, you will be remembered in history as the man who let New York get sucked down into the 10th level of hell.
And kick some slime.
Looks like a giant jello mold.
I hate jello.
Oh, come on. There's always room for jello.
Happy New Year.
Hose them.
Ghostbusters 2.
You're short, your belly button sticks out too far, and you're a terrible burden on your poor mother.
Bill Murray. Dan Aykroyd. Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis, and Ernie Hudson in an Ivan Reitman film. Ghostbusters 2.
We're the best, we're the beautiful, we're the only Ghostbusters.
Yeah. We're back!
Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
Thanks for listening to the podcast. Find the show on Facebook and Twitter at Real Comic Heroes. All music and audio are the property of their respective creators.